Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very, very much, Ambassador. That film, of course, was very difficult to watch. But if that doesn't get you angry, if that doesn't make you outraged, then you have no sense of justice. You have no sense of fairness or any sense of decency. The seven people that you see here, these are all human lives. Those are some of the bodies that you saw laying there. None of these people had to die. This did not have to happen. It should not have happened. This was totally preventable, and these people were killed not by some accident or by some misfortune. These people were killed because of very, very wrong decisions that were made by the United Nations and by the United States. And for that, I really am ashamed. So let me tell you some of the background of this. Some of you know it in great detail. Some of you may not know it at all. The attack on February 9 occurred just as we were about to have a session in Washington discussing this. We were all very shocked to find out about it, but I can't say that we were completely surprised, because this had been coming for some time. The possibility of this had been coming for some time. All of these people had been in Iraq for quite some time at Camp Ashraf, which was a camp that had developed over a 20-year-plus period. It was a camp that was a decent place to live, mostly made decent by them, by their own work, by their own money. It was a place that wasn't entirely safe. There had been two attacks by the Iraqi military at the behest of the Iranian government. There had been two attacks on the facility, and people had been killed. But because it was a large, large space, because there were permanent structures, because there had been places built to protect against bombings, it was difficult for people to be killed at Camp Ashraf. In fact, the only way they were able to accomplish killing people at Camp Ashraf was by invading Camp Ashraf with Iraqi troops and having to mow the people down in the streets, something that was photographed, something that could be seen, and something that the Iraqi government had to pay a very, very heavy price for. So instead of these people remaining there, being allowed to remain there, while they were being hopefully sent to other places under the auspices of the United Nations, the Iraqi government and the United Nations and the United States Department of State required that they be moved from that facility to what you just saw, something called Camp Liberty. I know the images of the people who were wounded and who died are the starkest. They're the ones that stand out. But if you have a chance to look at that video again, I'd like you to look at the structures that are part of this so-called Camp Liberty. This isn't a camp. This isn't a relocation camp. These are trailers. These are ridiculously tiny trailers that are sitting in the middle of an area that sometimes, for long periods of time, is over 100 degrees, that rains incessantly. These people are living in a concentration camp. I called it a concentration camp before they went there. And when we arrived in Paris to talk to Martin Kolbe, Michael Mukasey, and I, and a group of other prominent Americans, Republicans and Democrats, Ed Rendell, the former mayor of Philadelphia and head of the Democratic Party, and Louis Free, the former head of the FBI, and Senator Torricelli, a Democrat. I'm a Republican. Michael's a Republican. This is not about Republican, Democrat. It's about the right thing. First thing that Martin Kolbe said to me, he came up to me very, very angry, and he put his finger in my face, and he said to me, "You called it a concentration camp. You said it was a concentration camp. It's not a concentration camp." Well, you know, not only did I turn out to be right that it's a concentration camp, but it's now become a killing field. I don't know how Martin Kobler defines a concentration camp. But if you take a look at those disgusting, ratty little places where these people are being required to live, if that's not a concentration camp, I don't know what a concentration camp is. And on September 9th, it turned out to be a place in which people could just be slaughtered without any protection at all from Iraq, from the United Nations, or from the United States. In and of itself, this is an act of tremendous inhumanity. But it's worse than that. As I said, all of these people, or most of them, had been at Camp Ashraf. In 2003, I believe it was, when we invaded Iraq and attacked Iraq and deposed Saddam Hussein, all of these people in Camp Ashraf voluntarily surrendered all of their arms, their ability to defend themselves. They surrendered it to the United States military, to the United States government. And they surrendered the ability to defend themselves because they were promised protection by the United States government. The United States government gave them a promise when they surrendered their own weapons that they would act as protection for these people. To me, that's a solemn promise of my country. That's a solemn promise that we have now broken time and time again. The United States should be ashamed of itself in having broken that promise, because the United States was instrumental in requiring these people to leave Ashraf, put on tremendous pressure for them to go to Concentration Camp Liberty, put on tremendous pressure for 2 years for these people to move, basically threatened them, including the then Secretary of State, Hillary Clinton, basically threatened them that they wouldn't be delisted unless they moved. Now, what could that possibly have to do with listing or delisting? The group is either a terrorist group or it's not a terrorist group. There's either proof that they've taken part in terrorist activity within the last 5 or 10 years, or there is no proof that they took part in terrorist activity. If they move or don't move, how does that indicate one way or another if they're a terrorist group? So the pressure was enormous, because the MEK had been delisted in the European Union. It had been delisted in the United Kingdom. In fact, the only two places left that considered the MEK to be a terrorist group was Iran and the United States. The simple fact that Iran considered them to be a terrorist group should have been the best indication that they weren't a terrorist group. That was apparent 5, 6, 7, 8 years ago. This decision dragged on and it dragged on and it dragged on and it dragged on. Long after, as I said, the United Kingdom, the European Union had delisted them. And then this final pressure was asserted. You know, if you don't move from Ashraf to Concentration Camp Liberty, we may not remove that designation. And you're going to be considered as very, very difficult people, very difficult to repatriate, very difficult to move, very difficult to find places to live. It was important to get that designation removed, because one of the things that theoretically was blocking being able to move these people to other countries, as you would talk to other countries, they would say, no, I mean, this group, we know they've been delisted by the EU and the UK, but this group is still listed as a terrorist group by the United States. So in negotiations with countries to accept some of these people, that would become a stumbling block. So it was really important to have that removed. So that pressure was exerted. In June of last year, the delegation that I was a part of with Judge Mukasey went to Paris and met with Martin Kobler and his designees. And we worked out a 10-point agreement that had to be met so that the people would move. And Martin Kobler assured us that they would be safer at Concentration Camp Liberty than at Ashraf, because it would be right near Baghdad. It would be right near the airport. I put up a picture before. If you could put it up again, I want you to look at where this is. This concentration camp, Liberty, is a small part of what used to be a much bigger camp, Liberty, when we were there. It's in the middle of that area you see outlined in red. It's just a small little part. The rest of that area is a military encampment made up of the Iraqi military. And then right beyond it, right below where that water is, right beyond that water, is the airport. So Martin Kobler made the point that this is a very secure place to be. You're basically on a military base. You're in the middle of a military base, surrounded by the Iraqi military. And you're in an area that the Iraqis keep very secure because the airport and the military is there, and there are cameras all over the place. So this will be a safe place for them to go. Safer than Ashraf. He assured us of that. He assured us of that even though the facilities looked horrible, they looked awful. And he promised us that those facilities would be fixed. He promised us that there would be water. He promised us that there'd be electricity. He promised us many, many things. And the most important thing he promised us was they'd be moved out of there very, very quickly. That they would expedite the process of finding countries for all these people to go. Every single thing I said to you, Martin Kobler has reneged on. I believe every single thing he said to us in June was a complete, absolute lie. Because he has proven himself... He has proven himself to be a professional liar, which is unfortunate. I believe there's no choice with Martin Kobler that if the United Nations wants to do the right thing, he should be removed immediately. He is doing the dirty work of the Iraqi and Iranian governments. He is not doing the work of the United Nations. He's not doing the work of trying to protect people who are in a vulnerable status. These people should all be declared immediately refugees. They should be all given refugee status. If they're not refugees, then what exactly is a refugee? And I believe that my government, that promised them protection way back in 2003, that my government, that promised them that they would be safe when they were exerting great pressure to move from Ashraf to concentration camp Liberty, I believe my government owes a great debt to these people. And there's only one way to vindicate that debt. And that is, and I said this a week and a half ago, and I say it again, just takes a couple of airplanes. You send them there, you put them on the airplanes, and you bring them to the United States of America. And here in the United States of America, we shouldn't do this just for them. We should do this to keep our word. We should do this. We should do this to keep our word that we would protect them if they gave up their arms. We should do this because we should keep our word that they were going to be safer at Camp Liberty than they were at Camp Ashraf. The Iraqi government has now announced, by the way, that they can't keep people safe at Camp Liberty. It's not possible. They can't assure their safety. Well, I mean, if we need any other indication that we have to remove them in order to fulfill our promise to protect them, the Iraqi government has now told us they can't protect them at Camp Liberty. What does that tell you? The Iraqi government knows that there are going to be more attacks. And before there are more attacks, these people should be removed to the United States. I do not understand why that's difficult. I don't understand why that's complicated. 3,000 plus people are a small number of people. And if for some reason we can't find it in our hearts and we don't believe that our honor and our word is worth it to redeem it, If we don't believe that it's necessary to do that, then at least they should be immediately moved to Camp Ashraf, where they can do a better job of taking care of themselves. If we're not going to keep our word, if we're not going to take care of them, at least give them the best opportunity to protect themselves in a place that they built, in a place that at least will be harder to lob mortars in from the outside, a place that you have to invade in order to harm them. And this attack could not have taken place without the cooperation of the Iraqi military. I showed you that camp because I wanted to show you that the small place that they're in is surrounded by the Iraqi military. This would be like attacking the middle of Camp Pendleton in California, the Marine base in California, and the Marines not knowing about it. I mean, this was a short distance away, in highly secure area, in an area that's kept highly secure by the Iraqi army. So the Iraqi government had to have known about this, had to have tolerated it, maybe even participated in it, as they participated in the prior slaughter of some of these people. So they should be moved to Ashraf at a minimum. I believe they should be removed to the United States. Now, why is this so important? It's so important because when the United States gives its word, it should mean something. If the United States wants to be honored and respected in the world, we can't give our word to people, whether it's 1, 3,000, or millions, and not take seriously the fact that we have to keep our word. And second, it would be really, really important to change the dynamics of our relationship with Iran. We all know that Iran is on its way, if it isn't already, a nuclear power. At best, it's months away. We have tried everything through two administrations to stop them, the Bush administration and now the Obama administration. Over the last year or two, the sanctions have grown. The sanctions have become more intense. Yet just a week ago, there was an article in the New York Times that pointed out that although the sanctions were having a big impact on the economy of Iran, they were having no impact at all on the government, no impact at all on the Ayatollah, no discernible change in position, no real sense that even if we increased those sanctions by several fold, they would have much of an impact. Not only that, but as long as China, which is exempt from the sanctions, and Russia, that's exempt from the sanctions, as long as they can trade with Iran, Iran can get by. There are so many exceptions to even these harsh sanctions. Yes, it has an impact. On the other hand, this is a government that is operating on suppression, oppression. They're not going to be moved by our sanctions. So we can have more sanctions if we want. They're just going to move ahead and become a nuclear power. The sanctions haven't worked. They're not going to work. You have to be a fool to think the sanctions will work. Second possibility is maybe we can negotiate with them. Well, frankly, the President of the United States has been begging them to negotiate with him for 4 years now. The answer has been no, 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 no. Just recently, the President asked to have bilateral negotiations with Iran, and Iran turned him down. I don't know how often you have to be told no to figure out the answer is no. They're not going to negotiate with us. They want to have multilateral negotiations, not bilateral negotiations. And why do they want multilateral negotiations? So that Russia and China can help to delay things, to obfuscate, to avoid having to make an agreement, because all the while they're buying time. They're buying time so they can develop their nuclear weapons. And we are foolish enough to allow them to do that. The third option, of course, is if worse comes to worse, the administration has said all options are on the table. I don't know if that's true or not. I don't know whether to believe that or not, because the administration says that, then I see actions that the administration takes that I wonder if all options really are on the table, like their selection of the candidate for Secretary of Defense. So I don't know. But at least I'll take the administration at its word that all options are on the table if Iran does become a nuclear power, which they are months away from becoming. What that means is all options on the table means we would take military action against Iran. That, of course, would be very, very severe and very difficult. I believe if it has to be done, it should be done. But I also believe if it can be avoided, it should be avoided. We've tried sanctions. Hasn't worked. We've begged for negotiations. Not working. So how can we possibly avoid military action? What's the last thing that's left? And maybe the most important thing that we should have been doing all along in the first place, and that is to support the legitimate opposition to this regime that is one of the worst in the world. We supported the people who overthrew Mubarak. We supported the people who overthrew Gaddafi. They were all Time Persons of the Year last year. They were all heroes. We are supporting, I think, the people that are attempting to overthrow Assad. At least we're supporting them verbally. Now, if these people who overthrew Mubarak, Gaddafi, and Assad are doing the right thing, then why wouldn't the people that are attempting or should be attempting to overthrow the Ayatollah, the Mullahs, and Ahmadinejad, why aren't they part of that same moral cause of freedom, who should be listed as Time Person of the Year? The Ayatollahs, Ahmadinejad, the Mullahs, far worse, certainly, than Mubarak. Mubarak was pretty bad. Not nearly as bad as the regime in Iran, however. Gaddafi was pretty bad, but he had given up his weapons of mass destruction. He'd been kind of neutered, bad to his own people. Assad is terrible, but none of them compare to what Iran has done under this regime for the last 30 years. The number of people they've killed, the number of people they've killed as part of this organization. There's a book that's this big with all of their pictures, if you care to look at it. That's just a small fraction of the number of people they've slaughtered, of the number of American soldiers that were killed in Iraq with the cooperation of the Quds Force and the Iranian government. I mean, this is a horrible regime. We should be supporting the people who have a chance to overthrow this regime and not doing like we did several years ago, turning our back on them and leaving them in the street unsupported. Now, if we want to support a group that has a chance of having an alternative, then this group is exactly the right group to support. Our trouble in Egypt, our trouble in Libya, and our trouble in Syria has been we didn't know who to support. Were we arming people who were decent people, trying to create a free and decent government? Or were we supporting terrorists who were going to be worse? Looks like in Libya, we made some big mistakes. Looks like in Egypt, we made some big mistakes. Here we have a group that has been on record for over a decade of supporting all of the things that are most important to us. This group supports a democratic Iran. They support a non-nuclear Iran. They support an Iran that will be based on law. They support an Iran that will be protective of people's rights, that respects the rights of women. This is a group, president-elect of this group, the leader of this group, Madam Rajavi, by the way, is a woman. Every time I've gone to meetings, and Judge Mukasey can support this, half the audience, including in Europe, are women. This is a group that believes in equality for men, for women, in separation of church and state. This is a group that believes in all of the things that we believe in. And we don't have to fear that in supporting this group, we're supporting a group that has a whole group of hostile intentions. So I say, if you want to gain leverage in your negotiations with Iran, if they ever can take place, the very best thing to do would be to support the MEK as an alternative to the regime in Iran. Finally, I just have to return to where we started, because I'm so afraid, and have been afraid since February 9th, that another attack is going to take place. Because I believe that the purpose here of the Iranian government that is calling the shots, and the Iraqi government and Maliki, who are their puppets, is to wear these people down. The reason you move them from a well-constructed camp to a concentration camp that's ratty and rat-infested and horrible is to break them down, to get people who will defect, to get people who will leave, to get people that may turn over other people that they're seeking to harm or hurt. The Iranian regime is insanely afraid of the MEK. Those people who tell you that the MEK cannot offer an alternative to the Iranian regime just has to look at how frightened the Iranian regime is of the MEK. These are just 3,400 people. Why do they make such a difference? Because their act of strength, their willingness actually to move from Ashraf to liberty and put their lives in jeopardy, their willingness to stay together and not defect and not break apart. You realize how frightening that is to horrible dictators when they see that kind of strength? And they realize that that kind of strength is supported by hundreds of thousands, if not millions of people all over the world. They want to eradicate them. They want to destroy them. They want to break them apart. They want to break their will. That's what concentration camps are for, isn't it? To break people's will. That's why they have them in horrible, deplorable conditions. That's why they allow mortars to be fired in the middle of them and kill innocent people in order to destroy their will. We have to make sure that doesn't happen. We have to make sure that doesn't happen. Because they are our only hope. They're our only hope that within our generation, we can see an Iran that lives up to the wonderful Persian culture that is and was Iran, that lives up to the incredible accomplishments that people who were thrown out of Iran, people had to leave Iran, as they had to do over the last 30 years, the incredible accomplishments they've had here in the United States. These are enormously talented, cultured, civilized, and educated people. They are entitled to a government that is as good as they are. They are entitled to a government that respects rights, dignity, human dignity. It could sure change geopolitical politics. Maybe for once, we can be on the right side at the right time and be in the right place. And in doing that, we can fulfill the obligation that we have to these people, the solemn promise that we made, and we can fulfill our obligation that we have as Americans to spread the blessings of liberty to the entire world. Thank you very much.